Beautiful song, Lala, the banker musician that's here, starting our show for us. And this is how we start our breakfast and what we eat first. Let me quickly say a happy birthday to a deserving, wonderful lady. 80th happy birthday to you, Mrs. Alvira Tano, past president of the GBC Ladies Association, a true mentor from all the ladies of GBC, including moi. We wish you an excellent day, and trust me, we bring you a gift worth GBC sort. You can imagine. Yeah, also Papa. So you have lots of presents. So enjoy your birthday, Mom. But back here in the studio, we talked about in our intro that we're going to tell you how you can put a few things together in your various rooms, in your house, and wherever to fit it appropriately, the personality you are and the taste that you have. Choosing patterns for home decoration isn't always easy. There are so many to choose from. Have you ever been in a position of knowing that you just have to do something to your living room or bedroom but don't know where to start from? We are here to teach you exactly how to do that. And in the studio this morning, I've been joined by two special, knowledgeable decorators. Interior decorators. To my right, I have my colleague Emmanuel Atokwashi Ama. He is a designer here at GBC. Good morning and good to have you.
Thank you.
I've been seeing you around today. Yeah. All right, traveler fool. Mm-hmm. And I have Mira Wellington. She is a client executive representative at Think Mahogany.
Yes.
Good to have you.
Thank
you.
You
do all things
me.
With Mahogany.
I try.
What's the idea? I love the name. Let's talk about it a little bit.
Basically, I think Mahogany is a production.
Oh.
It's also an events management company. It's also interior design, photography.
Why did you choose that name, Think Mahogany?
Well, my boss chose that name because she's inspired by Psalm 1 verse 3.
Oh.
Yeah, by the tree planted by rivers of water.
Yeah.
But the leaves don't wither. And with mahogany, we never wither. We're always
in
fresh.
Its season.
Yes, in its season.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay. Wow. So good to have you on the show.
Thanks
it's
for
decorative
having me.
Enough, that name. So we hope that we will get into it. When you talk about interior decoration,
yeah.
what should come to our mind?
Basically, with interior design, it's trying to undertake something to give a space what it's supposed to be. And most of the time we think interior is just rooms, but then interior is just an enclosed space. So with events management, sometimes we have parks, we have places, we have rooms that we have to design interiorly. Yeah. So basically interior design is trying to add something to a space, a given space, trying to create an effect. Basically with interior design, you're trying to create an effect. You're thinking about the mood of the person. And you're also thinking about the people that will
use it. I like
that,
trying to create an effect.
Yes.
We'll get into, but we'll zoom down into our homes and how we can make some magic happen. But
okay.
Let me come to Emmanuel. What are the first things, for instance, that we have to look out for to when we want to think about, okay, I need to design this space or this environment?
Okay. The first things you think about is the effect of your movement in the room. So you look at how you are going to move in and move out. Then two, you look at your furniture. Which furniture will fit into the space you have. Your space might be very small, so you look at it and then you choose furniture that will match it and that will match your mood. And then from there you look at your color, how you are going to choose the colors that will match. Every room has a mood that it needs to portray. So you look at the color that will portray the room that you have, and then the activities in it. And then you go to your painting. When after looking at your color, you choose a paint that will match the mood that you want to create in that space.
Let me quickly ask that moods, we use the term mood swings. Moods don't remain constant and say, okay, I am a moody person all the time, so please occupy my space with moodiness. I'm sure there are days where you're excited. And how do you consider your mood then in the choices that you're talking about?
when you talk about mood, you're not talking about the personality, your mood, but the you take a living room. Mm. A living room is where you spend most of your time. Mm. So the colors you portray in your living room should be able to keep you there for a very long time.
So is the mood that you create to the space. Mira, I'll get used to your name. Let me find it again. It's Mira, right? Mira. Help Ima here to represent. And we just saw, okay, a couple of living rooms still rolling on our on our screen. So basically, the mood is not a person's mood. It's the mood you want to create around. Expand on it a little more with the things that he mentioned.
Okay, so basically, from what he was saying, I just want to add something. When beginning to do the interior design, you have to start from the mind. You have to really search within yourself. Because as you said, moods change. Mm. But then you realize that you're a particular person. So you're looking at personality. You're looking at basically what things you like over a period of time. Mm. And then with rooms, they don't remain static, especially, thanks be to God, I mean, with interior design, it can change. Mm. I mean, the house, the structure will remain the same. Mm. But with interior design, depending on the time and phase of one's life, it can change. Mm. So you start from the mind. At this time of my life, maybe when you're 18, 19, you are going for pink and things like that. Mm. But then going on 30, you're looking at a more matured look. Mm. So I would say that, you know, when starting, you start from the mind. Mm. And then you start with your purpose. Mm. What do I want to achieve with the bedroom, with the living room? With the living room, it's a place where everybody's coming to. People from various walks of life are coming.
What do I want to impress?
Yeah, but then you see, it's also a place where you're welcoming people.
Yeah.
And it's a place for family, you understand? So you have to start from the mind. Mm. And then the purpose and the function of the room, you understand? Mm. Yeah.
So, Ima, are you doing this? I mean, we've had personality here, and then You insisted that it's not just about the person, but the space and how you want it to look in the mood. Is it about what it will make you feel, or how people will feel when they come to enjoy it with you? Or, as you said, how it will make you accommodate a place as often or as long as possible?
Yeah, the space should be able to accommodate anybody. Mm. It should be a general mood you create that will accommodate anybody at a given period. Mm. Not that you look at okay, I am always quiet, so I want quiet colors. Next time
somebody comes around,
that person would not like to come into your room.
But that's me. I like it.
Yeah.
I like it the way it is.
Nobody would like to come close. Mm. But if it is a general feel that you create that will accommodate anybody, they would like to come again. Mm.
Mm. Mm. Let's look at means of, do we have the availability of the products, that the props, you call it props, yeah? Availability and then affordability. Let's combine that and see whether you can always create something for who you are and for the people to enjoy.
Yeah, there is availability and affordability. It depends on which store you want to go to. Mm-hmm. Some would like to create the same feel as a lower class would like to create the same feel as an upper class. Mm-hmm. And they will look at which shop they would go to. Somebody would like to go to Tasako. Mm. Somebody would like to go to Malcolm. Mm. They will get the same product, but with different quality and different prices. Mm. But you create the same mood by over a period of time. You look at how long do I want to create this feel. Mm. Mm-hmm. And then you go to the shop that you think you can get it. Mm. Sometimes you don't find these things in shops. Sometimes you find them on the roadside. Mm. Let me give you an example. I went to a friend who wanted to create a dining, but wants to give it a touch of an outside. Mm. You got to a place where they had cut down a tree and requested that he buys it. Mm. And they gave it to him. Mm-hmm. He created a dining table and chairs from those same raw as they are. Mm-hmm. They were not painted, they were not treated, they were as raw as they are. And he cut them into pieces. And he arranged them, and he had a
very beautiful set.
Yes, for a dining. Mm. but it's inside, but you have the feeling of outside.
Okay, I get that understanding. Let's look at, what was the name again? Mira. Let's look at the various rooms, the bathroom. He's mentioned dining now, and we've talked a little bit about the living room. Let's look at the bedroom, the refreshing room, and then the kitchen, for instance. In the initial discussion, we said the movement of the person should inform how you create your room. How does that help in the selection of whatever interior decor you want for your bathroom, the bedroom, and perhaps the kitchen?
Okay. Coming from the design point of view, basically, you have to look at ambience. Ambience is key with interior design, because as we have all come to this conclusion that, I mean, moods don't stay the same. But what ambience are you trying to create? That when somebody comes in, he's in a bad mood in your bedroom, what mood do you want the person to get when the person gets there? You understand? And then what function is the bedroom for? So basically with interior design, interior decor, you're looking at function.
That's the kitchen.
Okay.
Is it not too crowded? What do you think of this kitchen?
Basically with this kitchen, what's the function? What family are we talking about? What are their needs? You understand? Because the designer had them in mind, they had the people in mind, and then they decided this is how the kitchen should look like. In your, I mean, from your point of view, because of culture as well, you're wondering why is it crowded? Because in Ghana, we like to move about in our kitchens. We like to have open. My mother, for instance, always wanted a very big kitchen. This person, and I think this is from somewhere in the U.S., so you might have a small space to deal with, not like in Ghana when we have big spaces to work with.
So, and I said crowded because, well, they are lovely things, but I don't know.
Can I add this? When you look at this kitchen is looks crowded to you, but every step you take, you know what is there. And you don't move about so
looking
often.
For things.
Yes. Every step you take, you know what you are going to pick. So you don't move across the room from one end to the other, going to pick
a ladle or a saucepan.
You stretch, you pick this. You move two steps, you pick this. You move left, you pick this. So everything is well arranged. So there is not too much movement. But this kitchen is for a very big family, like a family of 5, 6, comparing it to this one, which will be for a smaller family of 3 or 4.
You mean the number of people serving the purpose will also decide on what decor you put there? I'm just thinking that if it's empty, there's no activity, and it was that crowded, that, like the other one that I thought was crowded, and then you start cooking and you have suspense and things all over, then it becomes
where
like
did the suspense go? That's something you have to look at the people. You know, you look at the people with design and architecture and interior, interior decor, you're looking at who you're designing for, you understand? And you look at the culture of the people and what they want. Because basically the family for the first one wanted what they got, or the designer gave them what they wanted. And then the second picture we saw, that's what they wanted, you understand? And then you also have to have in mind that with interior decor, interior design, you're looking at personal space. It's somebody's personal, the person's paying for it. So the person's personal space and how they want it. We here might think, okay, this is crowded, or this is too big, this is that. But then what does the person wants, you understand? And what is the feel the person is trying to achieve?
In other words, let's move to this. Okay. Okay, considering the space, perhaps it's even the picture that's making it look crowded or smaller or bigger. So let's put that aside and see from this point, what are the do's and don'ts then? What should you consider specifically when you're choosing perhaps a kitchen space, a toilet space for what particular number of people and family?
Basically, in considering, you have to look at your budget. You have to look at your budget. What money do you have available? What do you want? You understand? And I believe in the fact that I mean, a lot of times there are DIY tips, things you can do yourself. You might be walking around, you see some crown corks, I mean, it's not expensive. You can use that as something to do interior design. Mm. We don't always have to look at the casachua circles or the milkums. There's a lot of things, as he said earlier, that nature can give us.
Mm.
So you look at what you want, you understand?
Mm.
And then you look at your budget. And then you look at availability of what you want.
Mm-hmm.
Because sometimes you want the lounge couches. And then you also look at the climate that we're in. Because sometimes the lounge couches and the cane chairs work better in Ghana, you understand?
Mm.
So you just have to look at what you want, the weather, the culture, and availability of what you want and your budget. And then you work within that, you understand?
Yeah. Mm. And whilst you're considering that some other materials work better in a certain season,
mm-hmm.
if you can't afford, for instance, but there is something that perhaps works in other cultures that mm-hmm. is affordable, does it hurt to get it? Mm. To make your own design, if you can't afford a cane chair, but you can afford a leather seat, I'm sure it is the opposite.
You look at the size of your room, and then you look at the furniture.
Mm-hmm.
You don't over-furnish your room, because when you look at...
What would be over-furnishing your room?
Over-furnishing.
Clutter.
You clutter your room. You put...
Where did it end at what the person wants then?
Yeah, but then you also have to look at the feel you're trying to achieve. Because you have a goal in mind.
And also remember we talked about movement.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So if you clutter your room, there's no way you can move around in your room. I helped a friend move. And when he was moving, he had this big couch. And the entrance to his room
the new place
was small. And it took us close to an hour trying to figure out how to
push
the chair into the room.
Break the door.
We ended up putting the chair in the room, but it just one couch that occupied the entire room.
Mm.
It didn't have space for TV, it didn't have space for center table, it didn't have space for
any other thing.
Mm. So you look at your room size and then you furnish it accordingly.
Mm.
Cane chairs might be smaller in that room comparing to leather couches.
Mm, mm, mm. Let's talk about colors now, because lately I have a pink wall here, a wine wall, then a yellow wall in one big space, and it's acceptable. What's wrong with us these days? I have blue and white, I have colorful.
You have everything.
These
actually.
Days you can do that to your room. Let's talk about it. What's that style? It looks good anyway.
Yeah. Miss Max.
When did it come out? Asasa.
Asasa.
When did it come out?
It had been around. Mm. It had been around. I remember some interior deco books I was looking into. They used to have a painted wall against
wallpapers.
The wallpapers were well designed. Looking at it, comparing it to the current fashion, you think that it's non-starter.
Mm.
But when you look at the furnishing in the room, comparing it to the wallpaper and everything, it worked perfectly.
Mm. I mean, the people have said when you're putting on your jewelry, the less, there's this
less is more.
Less is more. Mm. Looking at what we have, I mean, the colors, but this one doesn't have the mismatch or multicolor. I mean, it's just the lemon green and the white, which plays. I think
it's the same
quite
thing.
Serene.
Mm.
It feels like outside, isn't it?
Yeah.
Mm. Mm.
But what I'm saying is, when did we come to? There could have been purple on the side.
Yeah.
So the lemon green, white, and then purple. Then you come to this side, there could be a few other colors.
The choice of colors come from...
What is this supposed to do to us?
It's supposed to create a mixed feeling.
Mm-hmm.
You not have it all in one color.
Mm.
For instance, a friend of mine was looking at colors, and he chose, for his wedding, he chose certain colors, and I asked him, you know the meaning of this color, you know the meaning of this color. When you put them together, do you know their meaning?
Mm.
Or do you know the kind of feel it creates? He said, no, just that I like them. Mm. He said, no. When you put them together, they also create another kind of mood or another effect. Kind of meaning.
Mm.
So you need to look at these things. The mismatch that we create in our rooms, there is a certain kind of mood the person wants to create. Mm. Wants to create maybe a room where you can stay for a very long time and a room where you can also have peace of mind to sleep, to do other things.
Mm.
So you put the two together and then you have it there.
Mm.
You might not be able to sleep because of the other color, but you might be at peace relaxing.
Okay, basically about color, what I wanted to say was with interior design, you look at how everything comes together,
mm-hmm.
how it all relates to each other, and how it can achieve the goal that you have in mind. We don't have to lose sight of the goal that we have for the interior.
Mm.
Basically. Mm. So when we think about color, that's what we should have at the back of our minds.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can I add this? Choosing the colors for our walls, we first need to look at our furniture.
Mm.
Because
you buy the furniture before you choose the wall, or you choose the wall before you buy the
furniture? No, you buy the furniture before you choose the wall.
The rest should revolve around the furniture.
Yeah. Not necessarily.
Okay. So, I mean, it's all boils down to you and what you want to create.
Yeah.
But everyone might not like it anyway.
Yeah.
But once it's nice and everybody is wild about it, you're comfortable.
Yeah.
But what are some of the things that you say, okay, oh, this you must have in your hall, this you must have in your kitchen, this you must have in your toilet, this you must have in your porch? I mean, what are some of the must-haves when it comes into your life?
As Emmanuel has been talking like on and on about furniture, function. It has to be functional. The space has to be functional. If it's a living room and it doesn't have a settee or any form of a settee, then it's not a living room.
Mm.
You understand? If it's a living room...
It's a Japanese living room, you squat or you...
Yeah, as in, if there's no place to sit...
Mm, but it's there.
It has to be there.
There's a mat.
It's a form of, you know, they sit on mats,
okay.
So it's a form of sitting for them.
Mm.
It's achieves the function of sitting. That's why sometimes it's even called a sitting room.
Mm.
It's also called a family room. It should have some element of family in it.
Mm.
Dining. If it doesn't have a dining table, it doesn't have their sitting arrangement, the Japanese kind of sitting arrangement, then why is it a dining room?
Mm.
Then it may or may not be a dining room, and it defeats the purpose for the room. So you must have function.
Mm.
Basically, that's one of the things you have to have in interior design.
Mm.
You must have function.
Okay.
Furniture, blinds.
You have flowers all over.
You can have that as well, if that's your function for the space.
Oh, these are nice colors put together.
And the flowers
What shouldn't you put in your room, for instance? Must that flowers necessarily be in that corner?
Yeah.
No matter what mustn't you, and picture placement. Must you have pictures all around?
Yeah.
Or you should have a picture room, or a picture wall area.
You cannot turn your living room into a study, and you cannot turn your study into a living room.
Mm.
Meaning that in your living room there should be functional things that should depict your living room. When you go to your study, there should be functional things that depict your study. When you go to your bathroom, there should be functional things that depict your bathroom. It's not that you have toiletries in your living room, and then you have books scattered all over the
So there should be the distinction.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Function.
And how about the arrangements?
The arrangement. Movement.
It depends on the movement.
Thank you very much. Next time we will bring the seats, we will bring the tables, and how you put the tables where and how the seat should concur with the tables, and how, whether there is a blind or a cripple or anybody else should be able to feel comfortable in the space. But of course, I'm sure you've gotten the basics of how you should put your living area into functionable areas. Thanks so much, Mira, and thanks, Emmanuel, for joining us this morning on The Breakfast Show. More coming up. Stick and stay with us. And remember, Ruthie is still in the house, and we'll be hearing more from her. Stay with us. We'll be right back.